Eduardo De La Cruz coming in here. He's going to tell us all about lameness. He's been with the clinic, the Loomis Basin, since 2010, and he's a graduate from University of Georgia. So he comes a long ways to come out here to help everybody. I don't know how many folks are using Eduardo. Yeah, awesome. Probably all you ladies, huh? Yeah. All right. So we'll get them all going. We'll run for about 20 to 25 minutes.
You're always out there.
Hold your questions. Hold your questions, because I'm sure once he gets through his presentation, he'll probably answer that question. So because it's hard to pick up again, so we asked if you hold him, and then I'll give him a little high five signal, let him know it's question time. And I'm sure by the time we get through with the Hawks and the PowerPoint presentation, we should be ready to go. So thank you all for coming. Just a reminder, if you haven't had lunch, lunch is provided for you out here. So jump in, we've got hamburgers and hot dogs. The cocktails were a joke.
Yeah.
And if you have those, let me know. All right, we'll welcome Dr. Eduardo.
Good afternoon, everyone. Hope everyone's enjoying the day here. Like I said, we're going to be talking about hawks today. We have about 20 slides, so we're going to go pretty quickly through them. Questions towards the end, please, unless they're burning and you have to do it. So we're going to do a quick overview. We're going to look at the anatomy, so that we all are in the same page as to what we're looking. We're gonna do what we do for evaluations, diagnostics, and then treatment of these. So we all know this is the back end of the horse. It's a tail, there's usually a blood around here. And then we come down the leg, and we're looking at the hock. So this is the area here. Sometimes I say hock, and people start looking at the stifle. So that's why I'm bringing it up. We zoom this area in, we're going to have more anatomy on that side, which is what we're going to be looking at today. I'll try to use my pointer, maybe not. So it's right here. This is the area we're focusing. We're going to be looking at the bones today because there's too many structures to cover in 20 minutes. But we're going to focus on the bones, and I want you to look, though, all these colored structures are coming down. Those are tendons and ligaments that also are affected in our horses and can create lameness. And so, we're narrowing down just to the joints today, but there's a lot of other structures that when we're looking at your horse, we're evaluating as we go. So, the hock actually has four, and if you ask some people, five joints. We have a tibiotarsal joint right here on the top. We have the proximal intertarsal joint right here. And then we have the two lower hock joints, which is the ones that we treat the most. Which are what we call distal hock joints, or the distal intertarsal and the tarsal intertarsal joints. And like I said, those we're going to be focusing today on our brief talk here. So evaluation-wise, when you call us out, your horse is not looking quite right, we're going to be looking at the horse, we're going to be palpating the limbs, we're going to watch them move. One of the tests that we do for hocks is we will flex what we call upper limb flexion, we'll flex the hock, but in doing so, we're also flexing the stifle and the hip, so we can't isolate that. But what we're doing, we're putting pressure on the hock, the stifle, and the hip, and we watch the horse go after we hold the leg off for X number of minutes, or sometimes seconds, depending on the horse. We watch it move, and then we want to see an irregularity in the gait. If the horse looks worse after flexion, then that means there's a problem in that region. We still have to figure out which region is it. Is it the hock, the stifle, or the hip? And most commonly on the hind, it's the hock. That's just basically like bending over like this and then running after a minute or so. I will be crippled. I will fail that. So we do this to this horse, and of course it's sore. I'm like, I know. But that's how we know. So we do those. We also, like I said, we palpate. We're looking for swellings, for any indications. Because as I mentioned before, there are other structures behind the hock, like the suspensory ligament and other structures that are back there that also create hind limb lameness. So we're going to be focusing on two diseases today. We're going to talk about arthritis and we're going to talk about OCD. Arthritis is extremely common in our horses. So we'll start there. So we got essentially two names for it. They're not exactly the same, but they're close enough to where they're being used interchangeably nowadays. So we have degenerative joint disease or osteoarthritis. We put osteo because it's related to the bone. There's other types of arthritis, like septic arthritis, which would be an infection of the joint and things like that. So that's why the osteo is here. So if you read it on your discharge instructions, that's what we're narrowing down what arthritis is. And in this case, will be osteoarthritis because it involves the bone. This will be a normal joint. When we have nice bone, we've got good cartilage here. And then we have on the sides, it's almost like a balloon. It's what we call the synovial structure, or the pouch, or the joint capsule. That's what holds the fluid inside that helps with concussion and helps with lubrication of the joint. So as we use our horses, and we'll go into it a little bit more, as we use our horses and ourselves, our hands, our knees, and things like that, we start, you know, grinding onto that cartilage if we do it excessively, and sometimes it's genetics, but we'll go into that in a second. We're gonna have some degree of deterioration of the cartilage. As we do that, then the bone starts getting irritated, the cartilage gets irritated, and the joint capsule itself gets irritated. After long enough, then the cartilage actually starts to completely disintegrate, and we have instances where we have bone on bone where it's touching. And every time that bone is rubbing against each other, it's like having a fracture. Where you have a fractured bone, you're gonna have rubbing, and that's gonna cause a problem and discomfort. However, if we develop a callus on that fracture, then you eliminate that discomfort. And we do that sometimes in these horses. And I'll explain why in a little bit, or how. So the clinical signs of hawk arthritis is gonna be stiffness that improves with exercise. So you'll see me launch a horse, and it's obviously lame, and the owner's like, "Doc, do you see it?" He's saying, I say, "Yes, I see it." Keep going, and we keep going. The reason is because I wanna see if the horse is gonna get worse, it's gonna get better. Because that's one little piece of the puzzle that's gonna help me evaluate whether this horse is arthritis, is it muscle, is it joints, is it tendons, ligaments, what is it? And now we'll keep lunging the horse for a little bit and torture him a little longer just to see what which way it's gonna go. So we're not trying to be mean, we're just trying to assess all these little bits and pieces. Stiffness, we'll talk about that, moving right out of the stall, we'll talk about it in a second. And then we have reduced activity level. The horse doesn't want to work too much. Starts getting tired soon. That's an indication. That also comes with behavioral. The horse is refusing the jump. The horse bucks after jumping or doesn't want to go into the barrel or do whatever that horse's exercise or program is for. So these two are common. We look at swollen joints. The lower hock joints on a horse, you won't see, you can't palpate inflammation or off the joint itself because they're too tight. But we can, the higher joints, we can see extra fluid in there. Excessive within the joint. You can have fluid around the joint called edema, but not within the joint. And then muscle, loss of muscle mass, and that is because we start, if we have a fractured arm and we put a cast, we don't use our arm, 3 weeks later we have a real beefy one, a real skinny one. It's the same thing, the horses do the same. So you'll see me occasionally go behind the horse, grab the tail and lift it up and look down the back to see if there's one leg is thicker than the other one. If there is that degree of atrophy of the muscles, then we know that we have a problem on that skinny leg usually. So I say we want to come back to stiffness or slow movement when cold. Well, I live that every day. It's like evolution in my house. I get out of bed like this, and then I slowly start walking to the restroom, and then as I take a shower and get ready for work, I'm already upright. So, same with these horses. You give them in a stall, you walk them out, and they're limping, and then as you warm them up, and they start stretching and looking better. Same thing. I live that every day. So diagnostics-wise, we have multiple options. We're going to focus today on radiographs only because we don't have enough time. But we can do ultrasound. What can we see with ultrasound? What are we evaluating? Soft tissues. So tendons, ligaments, joint capsule. We can see bone. We can see the attachment of the ligaments into the bones. So we use ultrasound as well because there's a lot of little bones within the hock that we need to look at, and they all have a ligament or a tendon associated with it. So sometimes that is a problem. Arthroscopy is when we put a little camera in there and we look with the camera and clean out any areas that need to be cleaned and things like that. And then joint blocks is also part of our lateness exam, where we go and put an anesthetic inside the joint, and then we watch the horse move after a few minutes to see if it helps the horse. If it doesn't help the horse, then we know we're in the wrong region and we need to continue looking. Because unfortunately, the horses don't talk to us. We can get some body language and things from them, but we have to put all this together to figure out where the lateness is coming from. So this is two x-rays. I gave you already a hint. This is a normal one. That's a non-normal one. But I want someone to tell me what is not normal about that one. And it has arthritis. Where are we looking?
Bottom two joints.
Bottom two joints. Very good. So these two joints are here. We have arthritis there. So I want you to compare, now that it's side by side, I want you to compare this joint space here versus this. This looks rugged. It looks like it's got a little bone spur going on there. And then we have the other joint, the same thing. It's got a big bone spur coming here. This is not very severe, but we see this commonly. And then we have not hardly anything in this one. This was not perfect. I'm trying to find a perfect horse out there. If it was perfect, we would not be x-raying it to begin with. So that's what we're looking for on that one. How about this one?
Same thing. Oh, nice.
So this one's more dramatic. You can see here some of the comments going on. So it's right there. Again, our structures in the limbs are 3D. So when you see us taking 3, 4, 5 x-rays of any particular area in your horse, we're not trying to make money. We're trying to look at all the areas because they're 3D and images are 2D. So I need to come around and look at every joint from any angle. This is the same horse. Looks way worse on this x-ray than the other one. So these are things that we keep in mind. Again, look how nice and clean. It's almost a perfect horse right here. It's nice and clean. You'll see all the ruggedness. You have the bone kind of fall off. Looks like it wants to fall off in the corner there. So that is definitely significant. So what causes this stuff, degenerative joint disease, osteoarthritis, whatever you want to call it, is repetitive stress. Runners, pitchers, any type of person, any of us that do quite a bit of exercise, if we overdo it, we will going to be putting stress on our joints consistently. And that's going to lead to tearing of the cartilage, inflammation of the joint capsule, and things like that. So again, repetitive stress, overworking joints, similar. Overweight horses, we'll come back to that. Age, infections, if we have a laceration or any type of abrasion right over a joint, you will see that we will many times go into that joint and test that fluid. We want to make sure that there's no infection in that joint. Because if there is, then that horse is now going to be pretty exposed to osteoarthritis after we heal it, or after healing. Plus, those infections are really hard to treat, so we want to be ahead of the game, ahead of that evil on that. Genetics, we see it on a lot of breeds. All breeds get arthritis for the most part, but there's some breeds that are more likely to have it. I'm not a fan of poor horses, sorry. But this is one of the things, because they do develop a lot of arthritis. But most breeds do. So I'm not just picking on the poor horses. OCD, we're going to talk about OCD. We're going to go into that. And then cysts. So all these things create inflammation in that joint. And that's what's going to lead to destruction of the joint. It's all inflammation. So if you know me well enough, if you have a fat horse, I will tell you the horse is fat. I will tell you the horse is fat. So yes, I will tell you why, because I am the spokesman for your horse, and I want your horse to live forever. And most of you want the same thing for your horse. So we try to make sure that horses are kept in good weight. Fat jumping horses are super fat. I don't understand why they're jumping people, sorry. You want fat horses jumping stuff. It just drives me nuts. But dog is broken, no shit. 200 pounds overweight, but he looks so pretty. Yeah, standing. So that's where we are. So please, give me a slip. All right, osteochondrosis, desiccants. All right, $20 will find a lesion. Where's the problem, this one? This one's a little harder. This one's a little harder. Any takers? There's a break somewhere. I like it, yeah.
Could this be a dark hole right between the two bones, and then there's a dark spot above the two bones?
There it is. All right, so I'm going to zoom in that area. And then you'll really see it. So this fragmentation of this bone here, I want to back it up so you can see it again from that bigger image. It's right here. So we have to look at that joint. These horse would have a swollen joint in most cases. That joint, we can see swelling. We cannot see swelling on these two on the one. We're going to palpate it at least. So when we have that in place, this is from horses growing too fast. Mm-hmm. I have race horses that are 18 months or 16 hands and 1,200 pounds. That's no good. I mean, they're growing too fast. Large breeds tend to have it more commonly, but any breed can get it. Mm-hmm. So fast growing horses. So we want to overfeed sometimes our horses and our babies, and we over supplement, and this is what's going to happen. They're going too fast for the bone and cartilage to keep up. And so either we have crooked legs or we got swollen joints, so we have this type of problem. Genetics, we see it in particular breeds. It's consistent in many breeds. A lot of warm bloods, I always looking for that, warm bloods when we're doing pre-purchases and things like that. And then exercise. These horses usually are fine until they're 1 or 2 years of age, maybe three if they're warm bloods, around four when we start actually working these horses. The defect is already there. We just can't see it. As soon as we start working this horse, it's pounding on those joints and the cartilage starts giving away. And then this shows up. It's not a death sentence by any means for the horse, but we need to do something about it. And in these horses, usually what we do, we go in there surgically with a scope, we find it and we remove it. If we don't remove it, we can treat the joint and the horse will be okay. The problem is you are now predisposing your horse to more arthritis down the line. It's better to get it out of there, get that sand out of that joint and let it be. And it will be way better, much better. And they can go back to full work at that point after some rest period. So you will have a horse that's still usable and very usable. And longevity wise, he's more predisposed to arthritis, but if you leave that stuff in there, it's going to definitely get arthritis and it's going to be quicker than you may want. So treatment of joints, there's many. For hock joints, the most common one is joint injections, and we're going to go into a little more detail on that one. NSAIDs being used, Vanamine, Equiox, those type of products help with inflammation within the joint. If they have quite a bit of arthritis in there, we will change their routine or the type of work they do. Sometimes we have to drop them one category because of the amount of arthritis. And that can come in pretty early, 3-4 years of age, and sometimes it's at 15 years of age. It depends on the breed and what the horse does, and its genetics, of course. Shockwave, you saw a talk on that earlier. That is, I like to use it sometimes in combination with one of the others. We have supplements. We're going to touch very briefly on that. That's always 300 questions with those. So we're going to very briefly talk on it, and then you can ask me later. And then arthroscopy, again, the scope. And then surgical fusion means that we go in there with the scope, we destroy all the cartilage, and we fuse the joint. Just like a callus on your fracture, there's a callus, the whole joint is fused, then there's no discomfort. That is what I call a salvage procedure. We do it just that's the end result. There are chemicals that can be put in there and then chemically fuse it, alcohol and things like that. I don't like to do that, but some people do it. That's just a preference for me. But anyhow, so once you fuse that, then your horse will not be painful there. However, it will have a mechanical lameness, so now it doesn't flex. So the horse is going to move different regardless. So it won't be perfect, but he will be comfortable at that point. So joint injections, we have a couple more slides to go, but joint injections, we can put different things. We can put steroids in there, like a cortisone shot that we get in the shoulders, knees, whatever it may be. Hyaluronic acid is another common one. And then IRAP is one of the, what we call biologicals that we use as well. And any of these will be okay, depending on the case, depending on the horse, depending on what it's doing, depending on your budget. You go from $50 or $80 a bottle to $1,200 a bottle. So it depends on what we're treating and how we're treating this horse and what he needs to do. So just very briefly, IRAP is a product that we pull blood out of the horse. We process it on some beads, we culture it, and then we pull that we centrifuge it, and then we pull the surfactant from the top, and then we move it into a syringe, and then we inject that into the joint. What we're doing with that is getting a product, natural product from the horse that we're gonna put back into its own joint. I cannot get the blood from this horse and poke another horse with it. It doesn't match. It has to be the same horse, we culture it, and then we inject it. And that has helped some horses that are have low level degeneration or arthritis. Some that don't respond to the steroids or the HA also. We've tried it on, and some horses do like it better than other things. So it depends on what we're doing, and depends on your budget and what your horse actually needs. If we have some soft tissue injury, let's say a high suspensory or a suspensory, IRAP will probably be the best one, because the steroid is going to inhibit healing. The IRAP is going to help with the healing of the tendon that is attached, the ligament that's attached behind the joint. So there's a lot of things that go into play when we are looking at to what we're going to use for your horse. This is the most common one by far. And to be honest, probably the best one. Then almost my last slide, supplements. These are the ones that I use. I don't have any stock in any of these companies, but this is what I recommend. This is what I've seen the studies, and my patients look better on these products. It's not for everyone. They're not super cheap either. But I like these products, and I like to use them. Of course, I don't pay the bill, but you guys do. But I recommend them. I use it when I'm doing pre-purchase exams, and I'm looking at a young horse, 4 or 5 years old, jumper, whatever it may be, dressage, for horse stuff, whatever it may be. I always ask, is he on any joint supplements? And half the time people take it the wrong way. They tell me, oh, why would it? It's only 4 years old. Well, because we're working the hell out of it. We should be proactive. We should stay in front of it. Why are we going to wait until he has arthritis to then go do this? So I start him early if I can, if it's feasible for the client, and especially if the horse is going to be jumping and doing other things that is pounding their joints. We need to protect them from ahead of time. I have horses that I've known for over 10, 15 years that have been on some of these products, and they're looking great still because they have been cared for over time. Yes, genetics is a big deal. Yes, training is a big deal. So it's not just that we're going to put this, a horse never going to get arthritis. No, but we're ahead of the game. We're trying to keep longevity and give this horse as much longevity as I want, as we can get out of them. So it does help some of the horses. Adequan is in the muscle, pentasan is in the muscle, legend is IV, so it's in the vein, a little harder for clients to do. And then when we have horses that don't like any of those because they don't like needles, then Platinum Performance CJ is the one I recommend the most. Cosequin is another one that's also okay. I like the injectables better because we get better results, it seems like. But if I have a horse that I suspect is going to get needle shy or is already needle shy, then this is what I use. And then remember, exercise is important for these horses. If you get a racehorse from the track and you put him in a stall and you wait a month, the horse won't be able to walk out of the stall. Why? Because he's going to be so tight. Again, it's going to be evolution all over again. Because they need to stretch out. You can't get these horses with arthritis and lock them up. Yes, at the racetrack they are locked up for a period of a time, but they're exercising every day. And they're taking well taken care of joint-wise and supplement-wise to keep them going. So just keep in mind, if we lock these horses up all the time, we're gonna have trouble when they warm up. But if they're working every day or every other day and things like that, then that's perfectly fine. Stalls are fine for horses. It's just you need to make sure they're stretching, okay? And then make sure you warm them up. I've never seen that. I was looking last night on the internet for the pictures. Put exercising horse and this thing comes up. If you have a great horse, I guess it'll be great. No poop marks on them. But make sure, again, warming up the joints is important. Walk them first. Keep them moving. Keep them warm them up well and pull them off well. That people kind of put corners on those sometimes, and we get our horses in trouble. I thought that was interesting. But anyway, that's my last slide. If you guys have any questions, I'll be happy to answer those. We have a few more minutes.